So it's my pleasant duty to start off the first module of this school, which is going to focus on networks. Essentially, we are going to use this as a language for studying a whole variety of complex systems. And in this particular school, we are going to focus on various kinds of social, economic, financial systems, and so on. So what I will do is, in this first lecture, I will just give you a broad, very, you know, like broad brush strokes introduction to the topic. And my fellow speakers in this module would be giving you very in-depth kind of view of how complex systems or very specific techniques of complex systems can be used to understand several types of social and economic systems. So the speakers who would be, the other speakers who would be, you know, giving the other lectures in this module would be Professor Aninda Chakrabarty. Aninda, maybe you could just wave in your hands. So he did his PhD in economics from Boston University. And from 2015, he's been part of the Faculty of Economics at the Indian Institute of Management in Ahmedabad. And his interests essentially include all kinds of, you know, complex systems in economics and finance. And he'll be giving you a glimpse of, you know, his research interests and so on. Professor Shottam Mukherjee, who's over there. So Shottam is a physicist by training. So he did his PhD in physics from IIT Madras. And then following a postdoctoral stint at Northwestern, he did his second postdoc actually at a management school. And then currently he is a part of the Faculty of Management at Indian Institute of Management, Udaipur. And his interests include, among other things, statistics of sports. And one of the talks that he will give in the evening, I think today's evening talk would in fact be on how one can look at sports statistics and infer a lot of things. But he would also be talking about more theoretical things like, you know, structural holes and so on, and how to use that to understand various kinds of economic and social systems. Dr. Shakti Menon, he's a senior scientist at the Institute of Mathematical Sciences, Chennai. His background is applied maths. He did his PhD on applied maths at the University of Sydney, 2009. And then following a postdoctoral stint at Queensland Institute of Technology, he's been with the Institute of Mathematical Sciences for the last several years. And his research interests include several kinds of biological complex systems, theory of games, and so on. And what he'll be talking about in this module, essentially, how one can combine games, that is how you can have agents making strategies and trying to, you know, like position themselves favorably in certain competitive situations, and social networks. So combining these two, you can actually see a lot of things about many interesting topics. For example, why doesn't voluntary vaccination always succeed? Which in fact would be the theme of his evening lecture on the last day of this particular module. And the last remaining speaker of this module, Professor Anirban Dasgupta, who would be, you know, arriving sometime today, he is a computer scientist. So he did his PhD from Cornell University. And then following that, he spent about 8 years working as a scientist at Yahoo Labs. After that, he joined the Faculty of the Computer Science and Engineering at IIT Gandhinagar. And his research interests are online social networks and several theoretical issues related to networks, computation, and so on. So he'll be, you know, essentially giving lectures on, you know, how you can use complex network tools to understand social networks, particularly online social contact networks, and so on. All right. So with that kind of very brief intro of my fellow speakers, let me go over to kind of a broad introduction to what networks are all about. And if you have any questions, please feel free to ask them. You know, I'll be happy to answer them. If not immediately in this talk, we can, you know, take it outside later, you know, during one of these breaks. All right. So since this module is particularly focused on social and economic systems, I thought I would start out by saying how, when you're doing quantitative analysis of social dynamics, you can actually look at it at many different scales, using many different types of perspectives. And in this picture, I've just shown two of these axes, okay, along which you can change your perspective, how you want to study such a social system. Okay. So for example, you could be interested and at how complex individual agents are. Okay. So for example, your individual agents could be fairly simple, so they are using some kind of a mechanistic kind of rules to make some act or to take some actions, like for example to buy or to sell if they're traders in a market. Or they could be fairly complicated entities, so they could be using fairly complex strategies in a game theoretic setting to decide whether one action or the other action is more favorable. And depending upon how or at what level of complexity you view the agents, you could have a variety of models ranging from mean field models. So those of you who are from physics, mean field is of course a term which is familiar to you. If this term is unfamiliar to you, so essentially what I mean is that here, instead of looking at how or what repertoire of rules or strategies that a particular agent is using, you just have some kind of a very, mechanical kind of input-output function where you say that, okay, if the market is behaving like this, I will do this. And if the market is behaving like that, I will do that. So for example, if you are a technical trader, then you are usually following some, fairly basic set of rules. So you say that, okay, if the market moved down for the last 3 days, maybe it will keep moving down. On the other hand, if it's moving up, maybe it will keep moving up. So you might be basically just following a trend. Or you could be something like a fundamentals person who might say, well, I have this idea about what should be the true price of this particular asset. And if it is trading at a price way above, then eventually it should come down. So maybe I will, buck the trend and try to, sell, dump it when it's like very high and buy it when it's very low and so on. So relatively speaking, these are fairly, simple kind of rules that one is using. And why you call it mean field? It's because you're not actually directly interacting with the other agents in the system. All of you are just looking at some common signals, let's say the price of a particular asset, and taking your decisions based upon this common signal. Okay? So any interactions within the system are entirely mediated by this common signal that is visible to all. In that sense, it's very much like a mean field model that we physicists like to use as our first, stop in the modeling business. On the other hand, you could have much more complicated situations where, for example, in a very classic game called the Prisoner's Dilemma, which my fellow speaker, Dr. Shakti Menon, would be introducing, it's all about trying to outguess what your opponent is going to do. So what the outcome of your action would be is dependent pretty much on what your opponent is doing. And so you have to constantly think of, second guessing your opponent. So you've got to make models that, okay, if my opponent does, this is how I should behave like. So would my opponent do that, or would my opponent also, try to figure out that I'm going to think in this way and then try to take that into account and, act accordingly. So you can have second order model, third order model, fourth order model, where you're constantly trying to figure out how your opponent is going to take into account the fact that you're also trying to outguess the opponent and so on. So this can lead to a fairly complex kind of modeling. And I won't go into any more details, save to say that, there are very interesting kind of problems which come up, for example, in cooperative and non-cooperative type of games. And I, in particular, point out that there's this class of games called minority games, where the winner is someone who manages to figure out which option would be chosen by the least number of agents in the system. So, it's like this. You have this option to buy or to sell a particular asset. Now, which of these would be more profitable is dependent upon what the majority of the people decide to do. So whatever they did, if most of them decided to buy, then it's profitable for you to actually sell. On the other hand, if most of them decided to sell, it will be profitable for you to buy. The problem is, of course, you don't know this beforehand. So you've got to anticipate what the majority is going to do and act exactly opposite of that. So if you think about it, that's kind of very counterintuitive, right? Because the moment you come up with a representative agent picture of this setting, the point is, you know, the whatever strategies you're using to predict what the majority would do, most of the people in the majority would also be using that same strategy, and they would exactly come to the same conclusion as you and do the same action as you, and so automatically you become part of the majority. And so you lose, right? So how is it possible to always buck the trend? So this raises some very interesting kind of questions, and this has been illustrated by the so-called Elferol Bar problem. So Elferol Bar used to be this very popular pub in Santa Fe. So I think on Friday evenings, they used to have live music. And everybody, you know, who wanted to have a lively evening out on Fridays in Santa Fe would like to get to Elferol Bar. But the problem is, of course, that if a lot of people, you know, get to Elferol Bar on that particular evening, you know, it's too small to accommodate everyone. So, you know, you face the prospect of not getting in and then the long drive back home. Okay? Disappointed. So on the other hand, if you decide to just spend a quiet evening at home, and most people decide to do that, then of course the very few people who do, you know, take the courage and show up at Elferol Bar have a fantastic evening. Okay? So the question is, on any given Friday evening, do you stay at home or do you decide to take that long drive to Elferol Bar? So the economist Brian Arthur essentially posed this Elferol Bar problem, and then it has gone on to be generalized and, you know, applied at various contexts like in markets and so on. Now, you could also go along the other axis, which is essentially talking about interaction complexity. So whereas here we were talking about how complex individual agents are, here we're asking, how complex is the description of how these agents are interacting with other agents, how they are talking to other agents, how they're finding out what other agents are doing, and in the end, how their actions are affecting what the other agents would be doing. Okay? So again, you could look at many different scales depending on how the individual agents in such a collective would be described. So for example, over here, where, you know, you have complexity in the description of the interaction, but simplicity in how individual agents are described, you could have things like, for example, trying to understand how agents who are essentially voting in a referendum will coordinate their actions. Okay? So one of these puzzles in social sciences is, why do people bother to just go out and vote? So there's this story about one economist who met another fellow economist in the voting booth, and both are extremely embarrassed. Okay? Because it's irrational to come out and vote, right? So both admit shamefacedly that it was their respective spouses who forced them to come and vote. Okay? Because it's the illogical thing to do. Okay? Why? Because an individual person decision to vote this way or that way is actually not going to the scale either way. So it's completely irrelevant whether you actually come out to vote or not. So why should you bother to even, like, you know, take the, you know, effort to, you know, make your way to the polling station? And in the case of my home state, West Bengal, actually, you know, risk your limb coming out and vote when, you know, it doesn't make a difference either way, right? So then how is it that actually, you know, some kind of a coordination happens in society, you know, if this is all there is to it? So if you just concentrate on people taking, let's say, binary decisions of voting yes or no in a referendum, and on top of that, you ask, how is it that they are influencing each other? Okay. So let's say your decision to vote one way or the other is pretty much dependent upon what your friends are doing. So if most of your friends thinks that you should, you know, they should be voting yes, then you are, you know, by peer pressure, you would be likely to vote yes. If most of them think no, then you'd be likely to say no. But it entirely depends upon what is happening in your local neighborhood. Okay? So unlike in the mean field model, where all of you are exposed just to some common signal, namely the, let's say the mass media poll on, you know, which camp has, you know, better chance of winning, where you're just, all of you are just having a look at this overall global signal. In this setting, your own neighborhood is much more important to you than what is happening in the entire population. So if overall, majority of the people are leaning in one way, but in your neighborhood, particular neighborhood, all your friends think in the other way, you're much more likely to go with your friends and vote counter to what the overall collective seems to be doing. So networks, conservation networks, can actually lead to behavior which is quite contrary to what you'd expect from mean field models. Okay. Now, as you increase the complexity of the description of the agents in such network setting, you can actually get different types of models. So for example, you could have a setting where the links that you have between the agents are themselves not fixed or static, but could change depending upon the actions of the agents. Okay? And one of the wonderful examples of such a picture is where you have the convergence to balance in social networks. So this was an idea that was first proposed by Fritz Heider, a gestalt psychologist back in the 1940s, who was basically looking at what kind of social relationships are stable. So he started off with some very simple arguments. He said that, look, if I have a setting of just considering three individuals and the relations between them, then there are certain triadic relations which are stable and other triadic relations which are not stable. So for example, if all three are friends, that's a very stable relation. Okay, so let's call them, Om, Pradeep and Zina. Okay, so they're all friends. So on any given evening, they would all go out together and have a good time. Now, if two of them are friends and they're both enemies of the third person, that's also a stable situation. So let's say Om and Zina are friends and both hate the guts of Pradeep. Well, whenever Om and Zina would go somewhere, Pradeep would stay away and vice versa. Very stable situation. But now, consider a situation where Om likes both Pradeep and Zina, but Pradeep and Zina hate the guts of each other. That's kind of unstable because suppose you want to go somewhere, you want to be with both of these people, but both of these people can't hate, they kind of hate each other, so they would refuse to be seen with you in that particular milieu where they're likely to encounter each other. Okay. So Heider argued that in such a setting where you have some such unstable relationships, eventually this would force the existing relations to change so that it will converge to one of these stable relations. In other words, if Om likes both Pradeep and Zina, and Pradeep and Zina hate each other, eventually it will transpire that either Om manages to reconcile Pradeep and Zina, so all three become friends, or it could be that Pradeep or Zina manage to exert their influence on Om so that Om becomes, let's say, friends with Zina and become a mortal enemy of Pradeep. Okay? So essentially, you could have the unstable triadic relation eventually converging to one of the stable relations. So this is an example of how networks themselves are influenced by the actions taken by the individuals who are the nodes of this network. And you could increase the complexity even further and have games on networks where the individual agents who are like interacting with each other over this network are essentially playing, for example, games like Prisoner's Dilemma with their network neighbors. And that, of course, leads to fascinating kind of collective ordering behavior in such networks, which Dr. Shakti Menon would be exploring in his talk. All right, so with that meditation, let me go to some more fundamental definitions. So what are, in fact, networks? Okay. So essentially, a network is anything which you can describe as consisting of entities called nodes, which are interacting with each other through links. Okay, so these nodes could, for example, be individuals. So, for example, traders, or they could be institutions like companies or insurance companies or mutual funds or whatever, or they could be nations. No, it's whatever your interest is in. The links could be, for example, links that involve buying and selling with each other, buying and selling from each other, or they could be links like, for example, mutual non-aggression pacts, or they could be, trade relations. So again, it's very general. Whatever system you can think of can be decomposed into nodes. One can define links accordingly, which is appropriate for the system that you're thinking of. And why do we study networks? Because when you have a system which consists of several such nodes which are interacting with each other, these interactions can lead to completely different behavior at the level of the system, which you will never expect at the level of the individual components, i.e. the nodes. So for example, if your components are traders and your links are essentially buying and selling of assets, so that your entire system is like a market, these interactions can actually result in something like a bubble, okay, where the market quite unaccountably suddenly shows a huge increase in the price of a particular asset without any reason for doing so. Okay. So people like start buying this particular stock, like as if there was no tomorrow, thinking that they would always be able to sell this at an even higher price. But surprisingly, at some point, suddenly there's a breakdown of collective confidence and the bottom falls out of the market and people suddenly start dumping this stock like a hot potato. And there have been numerous examples of such bubbles, starting from sometime in the 17th century when tulip bulbs in Holland suddenly became a craze and people started buying tulip bulbs for what would be the equivalent price of an entire estate. Okay. Of course, the craze didn't last, and within a few months, the market collapsed and tulip bulbs were selling at the price of an onion. Yeah. And people in other countries who were essentially laughing at the folly of the Dutch had to laugh at the other side of the mouth when within a century, very similar bubbles happened almost simultaneously in France and in England. So in France, it was the Mississippi bubble, and in England, it was the South Sea bubble, almost simultaneous within a year of each other, where, in the course of a year, these companies, their stocks essentially skyrocketed. People started, buying, and in the case of France, there were stories about how nobles would go to the mansion of John Law, who was the president of the Bank Royale, and essentially beg and plead with him to, sell them the stock of this company so that they could make, a fortune. And again, at some point, inexplicably, the market faltered. People suddenly thought, wait a minute, why are we spending so much money on this? Will we ever be able to find a person to dump this stock on? And initially, if one or two people think like this, it's still okay. But, if a large number of people suddenly start feeling like this and they start dumping the stock, people kind of, start getting suspicious and they start dumping the stock too and so on. Very soon, you will find no one who's gullible enough to buy the stock. Okay? And so, it essentially becomes a worthless scrap of paper. Okay? And such bubbles have been occurring almost with, you know, metronomic regularity across history. And one wonders, why is it that people still fall prey to such maniacal thinking? And so that's essentially an example of an emergent phenomena, something that you cannot explain just by looking at the behavior or the properties of the agents. You have to take into account the interactions between them in order to explain the inexplicable. Okay? Something which is only understandable at the level of the entire system. So the aim of studying networks, wherever they may appear, is to figure out how the interactions between these entities lead to complexity at the level of the system. Networks, of course, had a very long history. You can trace it back to Leonhard Euler, 18th century mathematician. And it is reputed that network theory had its birth from essentially a recreational problem in mathematics. So Königsberg, I think the present Russian city of Kaliningrad. So that had this, a set of seven bridges across the river which wound its way through the town. And the question that various people asked was that, is it possible to figure out a walk through the city such that you would cross each bridge once and once only? Okay. Now, you could try to do it with a pencil and a paper. Okay. You could try tracing out various possible routes and trying to see whether such a route exists. It was Euler's genius that he mapped this onto an abstract formulation, the first graph, so to say, and said that no such solution could exist. And it still remains one of the most elegant arguments in network theory. So from that to the present day has been a long journey, but networks remain as important as ever in solving what initially looks like an unsolvable problem. So the way networks became, quite applicable in today's digital age is when it was used to solve this problem of how do we search the World Wide Web to find some information or fact or data that we need. So if you look at how the number of web pages has been growing in the World Wide Web, it's astonishing. Essentially, it's been an almost exponential increase in the first decade, or after it was started by Berners-Lee back in the 1990. Okay. And initially, most people thought that the World Wide Web is going to be pretty much useless for any practical things, because suppose you want to find some piece of information, how are you going to find it? It's like searching for the proverbial needle in a haystack. There's this zillions of web pages, and somewhere out there is the information that you need, but how are you going to actually find that page that you actually require? So initially, there were these manually curated search engines which tried to solve this problem, but there was no way that you could actually go through manually and keyword each of these web pages, because there are just too many. Okay? So until Google came up with an innovative solution, which is, of course, what led to their big success, made them a enormous company and so on. And the solution they came up with, of course, is nothing but a network concept. So this whole idea of using centrality, that is, you rank pages according to how important they are, where the notion of importance is how many other important pages are pointing to you, is a revolutionary concept. But if you're coming from a network perspective, you realize that it's not something which is new. Okay? So in networks, the concept of centrality, or more precise, eigenvector centrality, has been around for a few decades. Okay? It's to the credit of the people in Google that they actually took what was essentially an abstract idea and made it something which was a practical algorithm. And of course, it led to an enormous success in searching the web. So it has had enormous impact on our world. And today, networks have been used to study, you know, almost like anything that you can think of, you know, in biology, in physics, in geology, and so on. Anywhere, any discipline you can look at, you can see networks are being used in some form or the other. What kind of networks are being used? So you will hear a lot about complex networks. So what exactly do we mean when we say complex networks? To understand what complex networks are, you have to know just a little bit of history of network theory. So before 98, essentially there were two theoretical ways of looking at networks. Okay, and these are the so-called simple networks. See, on the one hand, physicists would study networks which essentially looked like this. They were regular lattices or grids, and they had the following properties: that the average path length, that is, how many hops do you need to go from, let's say, this node to this node, essentially scales as a system size, or rather a polynomial function of the system size. And that's because if you want to go from this point to this point, essentially you have to traverse through all the intermediate nodes. There's no shortcut. Okay? So if you're asking what's the average length between any two given nodes in this network, essentially it would keep growing polynomially as you increase the number of nodes in this network. Now, the clustering, that is how many of your neighbors are also mutual neighbors, tends to be quite high in this kind of network, because typically all nodes within a local spatial region would have connections with each other. So essentially, regular lattices are characterized by having average path length, which is typically very large. So if you have a large network with large number of nodes, typically the average path length would also be pretty large. And the clustering would also be very high. That is, your neighborhoods are highly interconnected. Mathematicians, on the other hand, would look at a very different class of networks, the so-called random networks. And this had strikingly different properties from these kinds of regular lattices or grids that physicists would study. So here, the average path length would grow only as a logarithm of the number of nodes. There's a very simple argument as to why it should grow as a logarithm of the number of nodes, and it goes as follows. So the argument is this, that if you have a network, random network, which is extremely sparse, sparse means that any given node would have very few connections with other nodes in the network. That is the connection density. Okay, the number of links per node in the system would tend to be pretty small compared to the entire number of nodes that there are in the system. So if you have such a system, then locally you can think of a random networks as being approximated by what is known as a tree. Okay, so a tree essentially would be something where you start out from any node, and let's say each of the nodes have three connections. Okay, so it will look something like this. Now, in turn, since these nodes also have three connections, you can grow the network like this, and so on, and so on. Okay? Now, suppose you say that this is your node 0, then at a path length of 1 from node 0, how many nodes exist? Well, in this particular case, 3. In general, you'll have k neighbors. So if every node has k links coming out of it, in other words, if it has a degree of k, then at first remove, it will have k neighbors. What about a path length of 2? How many nodes would you have? If you have k nodes at a path length of 1, how many nodes would you have at path length of 2? K-square, right? Because each of your K neighbors would have K neighbors at a path length of 1. So you'll have K times K nodes, which would have a path length of 2 from you, right? So here, at path length of 2, you'll have K square next nearest neighbors. Exactly by the same argument, you could say that at a path length of L, you will have how many nodes? K to the power L, right? Okay. Now, what is the total number of nodes in this system? It will be K to the power L, K to the power L minus 1, K to the power L minus 2. So this would be your total number of nodes in the system. Now, I can make an approximation and say that if L and K are sufficiently large, this term would dominate all other terms so that I can approximately write, and this is just a simplification, okay? You can actually try to sum it up and figure out the exact calculation, but I can make this approximation saying that, look, this is the dominant term, and so this is true, okay? So now, what's the diameter of this graph? What's the maximum length that you'll have? Well, essentially, you are saying that most of your nodes are anyway at a path length of L from you. So I could say that this L, which is now dominating the average path length, would be going as log of n to the base k. Okay? And so this is how this argument of how the average path length goes as log of n can be most simply understood. And the clustering, unlike a regular grid, also fairly low. That's because the graph is extremely sparse. And if it is sparse, then you ask, okay, if I am connected to node A, and if I'm connected to node B, what's the probability that A and B are connected? That's simply equal to the connection density of the network, okay, which is the number of links divided by the total number of possible connections that there can be between the nodes, which is n times n minus 1 divided by 2 if it is undirected. Okay? Is that, if that's unclear, I will just go over again. So suppose you have n nodes. What's the total number of pairs that you can find from these n nodes? It's nc2, right? N choose 2, which is nothing but n into n minus 1 by 2. And so in principle, you can have these many links in the network. But of course, in reality, most of these links would be absent. And so if I say that my actual number of links is L, then the actual number of links to the maximum number of possible links would actually give my connection density. Okay? So if this number is fairly low, as it is if it is a sparse network, the probability that two nodes with whom I am connected would also have a connection with each other is extremely low. And so therefore, I can conclude that clustering would be extremely low. So you can see that a regular lattice and a random networks are starkly different from each other in terms of these properties. They're also different in terms of how the number of connections that they have is distributed. So for example, in the case of a regular lattice, each node has exactly the same number of connections. So they have what is known as a delta function distribution because all of them have exactly the same number of connections. On the other hand, for a random network, this would be distributed in a Poisson form. Again, that's something that one can very easily work out. You know, since I'm almost out of time, I'll be happy to kind of show you how it's done during some break. So, complex networks are something which is not either a regular lattice nor is it a random network. So, they have certain structural patterns. And one of the most famous examples of a complex network is the so-called class of Smallville networks. So I mentioned that before 98, network study essentially meant that you either studied regular lattices or random networks. And that's because in 98, Duncan Watts and his then advisor, Stephen Strogatz, wrote this wonderfully simple and elegant paper in Nature, where they introduced this idea of Smallville network. And if you think about it, it's such a simple idea and such an obvious one in retrospect that you wonder why no one else thought about it. But, you know, that's the hallmark of great ideas, right? I mean, once it's introduced, you always think, why didn't anyone else think of it before, right? And the idea was actually fairly simple. So they said that, look, we have regular networks and we have random networks. Can we show how to interpolate between these two extremes? Is there a way of smoothly going from a regular network to a random network? And how did figure out how to do this? They said, look, very simple. Just take all the possible links that can occur in a regular network, and with a probability P, you break such a link, you break an existing link, and just randomly reconnect. Okay? So for example, here, what you do is you break this link, and then you randomly reconnect this node with some other node, and this node with some other node. Okay? So the blue links over here are the ones which essentially have been inserted at random by breaking existing links. So for example, you have broken this link here, and you've broken this link here. As P becomes closer and closer to 1, essentially you would destroy all the original links and randomly reconnect them. So at P equal to 1, you would have connected all of them randomly, which is exactly what you would get in a random network. Okay? So just by changing P, you go from a regular network to a random network, both ends of which you have seen before. But in between, you would get some structures which are completely new. Now, why is this of interest? That's because while regular networks have high clustering and large path length, and random networks have low clustering and short path length, it turned out that Smallville networks have some property of a regular network, namely they have high clustering, their neighborhoods are highly interconnected, but some property of random network, they have extremely short path lengths. In other words, locally, they are like regular graphs, networks. I will use networks and graphs interchangeably, and so would several of the speakers. So just remember, whenever we say graphs, we mean networks, and whenever we say networks, we mean graphs. So they have the local properties of regular networks. Their neighborhood structure is highly interconnected. But they have the global properties of random networks. The average path length grows only as log of n. And this helped explain one of those, you know, long-standing puzzles in sociology, which was this concept of 6 degrees of separation, or the concept of a small world. In fact, that's where the name small world network comes from. So the idea of 6 degrees of separation was actually originally conceived by this person, Stanley Milgram, the US social psychologist, who essentially proposed the following experiments sometime in the late 60s. So he said that if you take two arbitrary people on this planet, how can we connect them through their direct acquaintances? So let's say, and this is what he actually did, that there's this clerk living in Omaha, Nebraska, which is here, and there's this stockbroker who lives in Massachusetts, and Sharon is a suburb of Boston, right on in the, yeah. So I would like this person to send a packet to this person, but she cannot use the postal service. She can only hand it over to a person who is directly known to her, and that person can hand over that packet to someone who is directly known to him, and so on. And every time a packet changes hands, the person, you know, who takes the packet writes his or her name and address. So, you know, if the eventually the packet finds its way to the target, I can just read off all the names and addresses, and from that figure out how many hands did it go through in order to go from this person to this person. So in this particular case, the packet found its way to this person as follows. So the clerk handed over to a self-employed friend in Iowa, at Council Bluffs, who in turn handed over to a friend at Massachusetts, who then sent it to or gave it to a friend who actually lived in the same place in Massachusetts. Okay. However, now it took a while to eventually find its way through the social network of this Boston suburb, as it made its way from the tanner to a sheet metal worker to a dentist to a printer to a cloth merchant and finally to the stockbroker. So this tells you something about how our social networks are kind of structured. It's not always easy to figure out that just because geographically you are in the same region, you would also tend to have a low network distance with another person. In fact, it took the shortest time to go from Omaha to Sharon, and then took a long time circulating in Sharon before eventually making its way to the target. So what Milgram did was, he sent out lots of these parcels, and then each one of these parcels, which eventually made its way to the target, he collected them, looked at how many hands did it go through in order to reach the target, averaged over this, and they essentially came up with the fact that on average, it went through six hands before eventually reaching the target, and that's where got this idea of 6 degrees of separation. Now, can you do a back of the envelope calculation to figure out why you should get the number six? No, you can make it slightly more concrete. In fact, the hint is right there. So you could start arguing like following. Suppose you say that every one of us knows about 100 individuals. Okay? So at a distance of one, that is someone whom I directly know, I know 100 people. And then you say each of those 100 people know 100 people themselves, so it's 100 times 100, 10 to the power 4. And that's my second order of remove, right? At third order of remove, I know 10 to the power 6, fourth order, 10 to the power 8, and so on. So at six orders remove, I know 10 to the power 12, which is like roughly the population of the planet. Okay? So you would say that, okay, that's the maximum distance possible between any person to any person. Okay? Okay. Sounds very simple. There's a big problem in this argument. What's the problem? Exactly. Our neighborhoods are highly clustered. So the 100 people I know, their 100 neighbors are not different people from mine. Those would be many of my common friends, right? And so this argument doesn't work. Okay? But still, we get the number six. Why? And what essentially the Smallville's argument showed was that actually to get the random network argument to work, you don't need it to be completely random. All you need is for a few of the connections in the original regular network, highly clustered network, to be randomly rewired to have extremely long-range connections. Immediately, globally, the network is going to have very similar properties like a random network. And that's why the 6 degrees of separation argument works. All right. So what we would be looking at over several of the lectures in this module would be types of social networks. And typically when we talk about social networks, now we mostly talk about online social networks like over social media and so on. But social networks have been studied for a fairly long time. I mean, they've been investigated by people in the early 20th century by using surveys and pencil and paper kind of surveys where you are just asked to find write down the names of all your friends and so on. And so typically those studies used to be over very short samples, so you could of course you need at most 3 individuals, otherwise the entire social network doesn't follow. But nowadays with social media and so on, we can scale it up all the way to billion, essentially, individuals. And the links, not surprisingly, are, you know, social interactions. And, you know, typically most of the time, you know, we don't have too many interactions. I mean, because each interactions involves, you know, having some resource, because, you know, all of us have finite times. We can't spend all the time on the phone or, you know, in talking to our friends. So there's only so many people which we can be friends with. And the kind of interactions that these are, could be phone calls, direct interaction, emails, trades, whatever. And sometimes these networks are also weighted, which essentially represents how strong these interactions are with each other. You could, for example, look at collaboration networks. So that's also an example of social network. So this is the, you know, how we collaborate in our own institution. You can build it up for your own institutions. You can also, you know, interestingly construct social networks in the fictional world. So those of you who remember the movie Love Actually, which was like an ensemble film, movie involving, you know, several pretty well-known actors like Hugh Grant, Emma Thompson, and so on. You can look at, you know, the social contact networks of others, which kind of, you know, fairly, you know, accurately reflect the social contact networks that we see in reality. But you could also study it for non-humans. Okay, so this is essentially a study which was done by two of my students based upon data given by Aninda Sinha of the National Institute of Advanced Studies in Bangalore, which is in this city. And what Aninda's students do are basically they follow the antiques of individuals belonging to macaque troops. So these bonnet macaques are the most commonly observed monkeys in India. You see them in cities, of course. But so these students essentially were looking at a group of macaques in the GKVK campus, which is actually quite close to this place, I think. So typically, these individuals live in you know, fairly large groups, you know, of the order of 40 individuals, multiple females, where essentially you have roughly of the order of 10 individuals who are adults and have very strong kind of social relationships with each other. So what these students were doing was that they were following these this troop and essentially making fairly detailed recording of how they interact with each other. Now, usually these individuals interact as follows. They, you know, occasionally when you see these monkeys, you know, when they're not actively engaged in finding food, they would essentially be sitting down where one is, you know, picking the hair at the back of the other. So this is known as social grooming or allogrooming. And the purpose of allogrooming is not just hygiene. Okay, I mean, presumably they are picking the whatever ticks or parasites from the other's back, but the purpose is more social. Okay, so by grooming, you actually build and maintain social relations with other individuals in your troop. So it turns out who you groom actually has fairly interesting patterns. Okay, so if you look at, you know, these different individuals, and the different individuals are actually ranked according to their dominance. So the most dominant individual has the highest number associated with it, and the least dominant individual has the lowest number one associated with it. Okay. If you look at how these individuals are, you know, spending time in grooming each other, you find that it's not homogeneous. It's not like every individual is spending equal amount of time grooming every other individual. Okay. There are very definite patterns in how frequently they groom other individuals, how much time they're spending grooming the other individuals, and also how frequently they approach other individuals. Okay, so there's this, you know, dynamics of power relationships which is going on in this macaque troop, which in some sense is staring us in the face when we look at these kinds of networks. So why would a network analysis of this prove useful? So it turned out that when we applied our methods to study such a social network, we found that unlike the male networks, which were, you know, differed from each other according to what metric we used to construct the network. So whether we looked at frequency of grooming, whether we looked at time of grooming, or whether we looked at approach frequency, the male networks essentially differed from network to network. Unlike that, the female network was extremely stable. So when we tried to understand the community structure of this, you know, the subnetwork structure of this network. So within networks, you could have groups. Okay, just because, you know, you belong to the same troop does not necessarily mean that you essentially have equally close relationships with everyone else. So you could have cliques where within a population, certain individuals, you know, prefer to interact within themselves, certain other individuals prefer to interact within themselves. So if you use the network analytic tools for finding these subnetworks, you find that always, regardless of what you use to construct these networks, you have consistently the same modules turning up for the female network. And this is interesting because Aninda told us that unlike males, where the relationships are extremely fluid, the guy who's the top dog today can be beaten to shit the next day and essentially end up at a rank which is much lower. So it's extremely fluid. The males are always, you know, trying to, you know, figure out, you know, okay, is this the right day to, you know, become the leader of the troop? And there's a lot of fighting going on. The females, on the other hand, are very stable. Okay, so it doesn't matter, you know, like between, you know, today and tomorrow and the year after, when you come back, you still find that the matriarch is always the same individual and the next in line is always the same individual and so on. Okay, it's almost like it's set in stone. Okay, so in some sense, it reflects that stability. Okay, but more interestingly, we found that there is this clean division between individuals 1, 3, 4, 5, and 6, and 2, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, consistent across frequency, time, and approach frequency. And this was very exciting because Aninda told us, and this we didn't know before we did the analysis, that when they went back a couple of years later and redid and, you know, looked at the group, they found that the group had actually split and formed two separate groups, because in the meantime, the individual one had died. Okay? So in some sense, individual one was the glue which was connecting, which is keeping these two modules connected. As soon as individual one died, it exactly split along this fault line, and individual 6543 essentially split off and formed their own separate group. So this is something amazing, right? I mean, you use an abstract network concept of modules. You just apply it on the social network that you have, and you can predict what would happen a few years down the line when some event like some individual dying will happen. Okay? And that's the magic of network analysis when applied to social slash economic data. So I will end here and, you know, give over the podium to my next speaker, except that I will just end with with a list of references, which is, you know, fairly general. They are not specialized to social and economic networks as such. The best textbook actually on this area is the book by Mark Newman, published by Oxford University Press, which has just come out with a second edition. So if you want to, if you are thinking of, you know, getting in depth into networks, I would request you to, you know, somehow get a copy of this book, because it's just the best possible textbook you'll ever find in the area. Yeah. If you are interested more on dynamics on networks, like, you know, how epidemics propagate on networks and so on, you could take a look at this book, which is basically more specialized on looking at dynamical process on networks. Now, this is a bunch of papers, mostly introductory and review papers. You know, there's like, probably by now, there are probably 10,000 papers on complex networks. It's impossible to keep track of all these papers. So, but you know, you could, for example, try to get a glimpse of what the early days of network science were like by looking at this article by Steve Strogatz of the Small World Network fame, where he kind of looks at in the very early days of network as to what are the prospects and so on, and then follow it up with a review of Mark Newman and another review by Dogovson and Mendes, which looks essentially at evolution of networks. So I've been mostly talking about static networks, but you can also see that networks can change over time. So Dogovson and Mendes looked at how networks can evolve. And the dynamics of networks have been reviewed by Bocaletti. And many of these pioneering papers have been collected together in this edited book of Newman, Barabashi, and Watts in the structure and dynamics of networks. Now, popular science books are also often very important, giving you a taste and flavor of the field. And so, two very nicely written popular books in this area. One of them is Duncan Watts, again, which is 6 degrees. And it actually has, you know, it's very much in resonance with the theme of this meeting, because Duncan Watts is now at the sociology department. So he's been mostly looking at social networks and, you know, networks related to, you know, how humans interact with each other. So the book 6 degrees is basically his personal narrative of how he got into the field and what kind of interesting problems he has been tackling with, you know, ever since the Small World Networks paper. It's a very nicely written narrative. Barabash's book, Linked, which is slightly older, is also pretty nice. So he gives, you know, some of the older history of, you know, how networks ideas have been around for a fairly long time. So that's also a nice narrative. Okay, so with that, I would give the podium over to Aninda, who would take you over to, you know, a more rigorous analytical framework for understanding networks. Okay, so maybe we can take the questions during the break time. Yeah.